Hey there, welcome back to our Sky Tonight program. My name is Seth Mayo. I'm the curator of astronomy for the Loma Planetarium at the Museum of Arts and Sciences. And in this edition of the program, we're covering the dates of November 29th through December 5th. We're going to start things off by talking about Venus nearing its highest point around this time above a horizon. Then we'll mention the Moon and Mars getting fairly close to each other in the early morning sometime this week. We'll follow that up with a very brief discussion of the solar eclipse occurring in Antarctica. And we'll end things by talking about the celestial highlights that we'll find for the month of December. So let's get to it. We can all agree that the planet Venus, the second planet from the Sun and the brightest planet that we can see from Earth that we find right here above the southwestern horizon just after sunset, a little bit after 6 p.m. local time, has been so nice this fall, and it still shines really great as we head into the winter time in just a few weeks. So Venus is still really nicely placed, and right now, at least for us locally, Venus is at its highest above the horizon. Now, last month in October, we did mention that Venus was at what's called greatest elongation east, when it's farthest east from the Sun, which you think that would mean it would be highest then, but it's slightly different. So to explain why there is a difference, even though Venus isn't actually farthest from the Sun right now in its orbit, we can actually change the date here. So let's do that right now. We're going to put up our little date window here. We'll go back a month to the greatest elongation east date. So that's October 29th, just a month ago here. And I gotta change the time because we have to go back to daylight saving time here. There you go. And so now we can see Venus still pretty high up then, but there is a difference here in that it's just slightly lower. So to explain this even further, let's turn on what's called the ecliptic line. So this is the path of the planets in our solar system. This is also the path of our Sun as well. This is basically the plane of our solar system that we find here. So you see Venus there. Hey, there's Saturn and Jupiter pretty much along this line as well. The ecliptic line can vary depending on the time of the year. Its angle to the horizon can be different because Earth is tilted, and as we go around the Sun, that tilt in relation to the ecliptic is changing. As we move ahead in time through this month, we'll actually see this ecliptic line kind of angle higher and higher in relation to the horizon. And as we get to the 29th, or at least for this week here, we'll find that ecliptic line just a little bit higher up, which means Venus is also higher up after sunset. So even though Venus isn't farthest from the Sun right now as it could be, the angle of its path is higher as we've gone around the Sun in just that month time span, giving us a little more view of this brilliant planet. Now, the highest point of this can also vary depending on your location. For us here in Daytona Beach in Florida, it's around this week or so, but for some this could have been last week, for others it could be next week, and also the height above the horizon can change depending on your latitude. So if we move ourselves around the Earth here, I'll just pull up the Stellarium map, and we have it set to our location. Let's just say we go farther north, and if we do, you're going to notice Venus a lot lower in the sky. So if you go north, you're not going to see Venus as much, it's not as high above the horizon at the same time. As we go farther south, let's say we go down closer to the equator here. If we do, it's even higher up there. So the farther south you go, the higher Venus will get, and the farther north you go, the lower it gets, at least as we're talking about the northern hemisphere. So you can kind of play around with sort of where Venus is at this time in different parts of the world. You can kind of see the difference here, but at least us in this location here, we have, and I'll just click kind of generally where we are, right about there, or even type it in. Here we can actually type in our museum. We have it saved in Stellarium. There we go. It's pretty decent because we're pretty far south here, and it means we have the most time to see the planet before it sets. If you're up early in the morning this week, just as the Sun is beginning to rise, or at least just before, you have a chance to see the crescent moon visit the planet Mars. Now just keep in mind, Mars is very close to the Sun and it's not that bright right now, so it may be a bit difficult to find. But if we look very near the east at southeastern horizon, right down here, there we can see that little kind of reddish speck right there. That is Mars, the fourth planet from our Sun. Of course, we call it the red planet. When it's bright enough, you will see a little bit of that reddish glow. So this is on November 30th here with the crescent moon a little bit higher in the morning. But let's say we move ahead in time, and if we do, we'll find that crescent moon waning still, getting a little closer to Mars on December 1st. Then by the 2nd, you have a very, very thin crescent moon and also Mars nearby. So this is when these two solar system objects will be at their closest. And then the morning after, on the 3rd, you'll find the moon dip below as it starts to near what's called a new moon phase, when we can't see the moon as its backside is being lit. So if you do get up at the right time and you have a nice clear view of the eastern horizon, you may find Mars and the moon get fairly close to each other, especially on the morning of December 2nd. If you happen to find yourself in Antarctica later this week on Saturday, which I'm assuming most of you won't, but just say hypothetically you were, then in the morning on December 4th, you'd have a chance to see a total solar eclipse. And that, of course, is when the moon, during a new moon phase, when the backside of it is being lit, covers the sun for a brief moment, turning the day into night, which is absolutely an extraordinary thing to see in nature. I've only had a chance to see it once, and it changed my life. The reason why I want to show this, even though most of us won't have a chance to see this, is because I just wanted to mention that anytime you have an eclipse like that partial lunar eclipse that we had recently, maybe you had a chance to see that in your early morning sky, you always have a solar eclipse that happens either 2 weeks before it or 2 weeks after it. That's the interesting thing about eclipses. They always come in pairs. So the same for a solar eclipse. A solar eclipse is usually preceded by a lunar eclipse 2 weeks before, or it happens 2 weeks after it. So that little connection is always fun to talk about here. So let's just say we were in Antarctica, and right now it's nearing the summertime, which means the sun pretty much never sets. It just makes a big circle in the sky, which is totally weird. And I know the landscape I have set in Solarium is not exactly what Antarctica would look like. I don't think you'd be seeing trees and a huge row of cars like this. This doesn't seem right for Antarctica. I just was trying to find a snowy scene here. But if you were there in that part of the world and you were watching this unfold here, you would find very slowly the moon, if you had eclipse glasses, would be starting to cover the sun. And then you could take off your eclipse glasses once the moon completely covers the sun, just for that brief moment. And all of a sudden you'd be seeing objects in the sky, planets, stars, and all that kind of great stuff. And then the moon would move past that out of the sun's view for the end of it. And this video does a great job of showing the path of the sun's shadow across Antarctica in this global view. Those circles indicate the percentage that the sun would be covered by. If you're in the inside of where the X is, that's the path of totality. And that's where you'd find your day turned to night for a brief moment, giving you that total solar eclipse. And that video kind of reminds you that most of the time, a solar eclipse like this usually happens over the ocean or somewhere where no one is around, because the moon's shadow over the Earth is very, very small. But again, it's always fun to remember that eclipses come in pairs, and that when you have one, expect one that happened already or one that will happen 2 weeks later, as we have for this solar eclipse following the lunar eclipse we had recently. As we highlight the prominent celestial events that are coming up in December, we can start with December 7th, when we have Venus, as we talked about earlier, this time getting the brightest in our sky. Venus will really, really shine, and on the evening of December 7th, it's reaching a bright magnitude of -4.89. And just as a reminder, the lower the number for magnitude, the brighter it gets. And this really puts Venus in front of all the other planets in the solar system in terms of brightness. It really, really shines, and brighter than any star in the sky as well. So this is a great time to see Venus, really showing off why it's the most brilliant planet that we can see from Earth. Later this month, we can look forward to one of the year's very best meteor showers. And this time we have what are called the Geminids, named after the constellation of Gemini that we find right here, the Gemini twins from Greek mythology, that great wintertime constellation. And the radiant point for the Geminids is near one of the heads of the Gemini twins, this star here called Castor. The other twin is named Pollux, but we have Castor here and the radiant point there for the Geminids that we see there. And this is best seen in the morning of the 14th, but also can be viewed in the evening of the 13th as well. And if you have all the right conditions met with a clear sky and it's very, very dark, you can see up to 120 meteors per hour. That is a great number, but this year, you'll find that there is a waxing gibbous moon nearby, which makes it a little more difficult. That moon will provide a little bit of light pollution, which will diminish the number of meteors that you can see. It does help if you get out just before sunrise, because by then the moon would have set. As we get into maybe about 3, 4, even 5 o'clock in the morning, you'll find Gemini is still very, very high up and the moon has set, which gives you a little bit better conditions for seeing some of the meteors shooting from this meteor shower. And this one is particularly interesting because it's one of the few that comes from an asteroid instead of a comet, an asteroid known as 3200 Phaeton. So hopefully this year you'll have a chance to see a little bit of the Geminides, even though the moon is not favorable for the viewing of it this time around. This December, in the evening of December 18th or the morning of December 19th, we have our full moon. And for this time of year, the full moon is called the cold moon. And it's kind of obvious for us here in the Northern Hemisphere. This is a colder time of the year as winter time is just upon us and about to begin. So with those cooler temperatures and a full moon, the cold moon makes a lot of sense. So we can look out for that full moon embedded in some wonderful wintertime constellations you can see around it at this time of the year. On December 21st at precisely 1550 UTC, for us local time that's 1050 in the morning, we have the precise moment of the December solstice. For us in the Northern Hemisphere, this is the winter solstice, when the sun is lowest in our sky or farthest below the celestial equator that we find here. For those in the Southern Hemisphere, this is when the sun is highest in their sky, marking the beginning of summertime instead. So we can celebrate, at least here in the Northern Hemisphere, the beginning of wintertime when the sun is at its extreme southerly location, making for the shortest day, longest night, and a reminder of the change of the seasons throughout the year. Looking ahead at the general night sky for the month of December, we can start in the southwest, where we still have a wonderful view of three planets. And the one closest to the horizon that's also the brightest is the one we've just talked about recently, and that's the planet Venus. Still really brilliant. We still have some time to see it as we move through the rest of the year. Just above Venus, we have a chance to find the beautiful ringed planets of Saturn, which is a bit dimmer, but beautiful through a telescope if you have a chance to see it. And then above that, a little bit brighter than Saturn, and of course the largest planet in the solar system, is the planet Jupiter. So these three, what look like non-twinkling stars, have been kind of bunching together in the southwest lately, and that makes for a really nice planetary viewing area just after sunset. Now just sliding a bit more to the west here, at this time in the evening, we can start to say farewell to that wonderful summer triangle made by those three stars of Altair, the brightest of the three, Vega, and Deneb. The summer triangle is so prominent, we see it for half the year, first visible in the summer, and finally by this time of year, it is getting lower in the sky. And of course, those three stars are part of separate constellations. Vega is part of the really tiny group of stars called Lyra the Harp. Deneb up here is the tail of Cygnus the Swan, which looks like a big cross in the sky. And Altair is part of Aquila the Eagle. Those three constellations left over from the summer and fall are still technically visible in the west, but they're finally getting lower in the sky. Now, as we move higher up, at this time in the evening, we have a wonderful view of those fall constellations. And this is a great time to see them because after sunset, they're pretty much straight up. We'll start with this big square shape right here that makes up the body of Pegasus the Winged Horse. The square is called the Great Square. That's the asterism here. I'll turn on Pegasus the Winged Horse that we find right there. If we kind of turn ourselves around here, we'll give us a better view of the northeastern part of the sky, just a bit more here. And not too far from Pegasus are his fall cohorts, most notably the W shape that we can easily find right now that is part of what's called Cassiopeia, the Great Queen. And her daughter is nearby that's also connected to Pegasus, and that is Andromeda. In last week's episode, we talked about the Andromeda galaxy located right that little smudge of light. So still great to see that. Just below Andromeda, she's a princess, is the one who saved her from those ancient stories. And that is Perseus, this mighty warrior that you find right down there. And another constellation I don't get a chance to mention very often for the fall is about in this area here. This is Aries the Ram, and these two stars kind of shine for Aries in that part of the sky. I'll turn on those pictures to see them a little bit better. And since winter is around the corner, we have to talk about those wintertime constellations that are finally rising higher and higher in the east. And you can see actually not too late into the evening. So let's do that now. We'll go a little bit later here. We'll move past 6:30 local time, and we'll just head into a time where we can see all of those wintertime stars and constellations all at once. So we'll head into just after 10:30, right about there. And I have to mention the first one that I think is the most noticeable out of all of these, and that is Orion the Hunter. We have a great view of Orion right here. Here are the three stars of his belt that are so recognizable in the sky. Here are his shoulder stars. That star is Betelgeuse. We have the legs and feet of Orion. We can click on at least this star, Rigel's left foot, creating the drawing of Orion the Hunter, that mighty warrior. What's always great is his belt points to a couple interesting things here. His belt pointing upwards goes to the V shape, the nose, and a very noticeable section of Taurus the Bull. We have Aldebaran there. Along the back of Taurus, we have the Pleiades star cluster, which is really, really great to look out for, that we find right there. And on the other side of Orion's belt, if you use Orion's belt to point downwards, you can find the brightest star in the sky, really getting a little higher above the east, and that's Sirius, part of Canis Major, the big dog of Orion's hunting dogs. And if you move to the north of that, we have this star here along with another one, making for a very tiny dog known as Canis Minor, also one of Orion's hunting dogs. Just above that, we have the Gemini twins we talked about earlier here. Here are the heads of the twins. So we have Castor and Pollux that we find there. And then above that, a really bright star that's sometimes overlooked and doesn't get enough attention, at least the constellation that is a part of. We have this star here called Capella, which is part of Auriga the Charioteer. So that's one constellation you really need a lot of imagination for. We'll turn on the pictures here. So all of these stars and constellations are great right now. The wintertime ones just peaking above the east, with the fall stars pretty much straight up once the sun sets, and even some leftover summertime objects setting in the west here, along with those planets we saw earlier, Venus, Saturn, and Jupiter, if you're out not long after sunset. So our December skies brings us really a lot to see, which is something we can all look forward to. That concludes another edition of our Sky Tonight program. Thank you very much for tuning in. And if you're in the area in Daytona Beach, please stop by the Museum of Arts and Sciences. And while you're here, check out one of our shows in our Lowell and Nancy Lohman Planetarium. We're running them daily. And if you want any more information about our programs, please check online. So we hope to see you back here again. And with that, I'll say happy stargazing.